So just a little while ago, you might recall I did a build video revolving around a consumable item in Core Tyria in the open world. It was an ice gun, and it completely broke the game. You would spam the auto attack on it, it would apply chill, and as a Reaper, you could convert that into bleeds. You could do insane damage. You could solo anything you liked in seconds. It was horrendously broken, and then naturally it got nerfed. Well, what if I told you there was something else like that still in the game? Been here since launch, and I knew about it back with that ice flamethrower video. Well, now I think it's a pretty appropriate time to talk about the other variation. It's a lot more specific, but it's still insanely OP. It'll help you pull massive numbers, particularly at world bosses and anywhere where there's large zergs of enemies. And since at the moment I'm talking about Firebrand, and at the moment I've been talking about open world builds, I figure this will slot in quite well. This is not actually what I'm recommending as a standard open world build for people to use. It has very little quality of life, and it's more about the world boss side of things and the large scaled event side of things than anything else. There's also the simple fact it might get nerfed. Which I said at the head of the series, I don't really want to recommend things like that. But in the meantime, they are kind of amazing to show off and to play with. So get in there. But so let's check out the Guardian with the flamethrower. So yes, if you have a look at my inventory right now, on the top left, you'll see I have an item called flamethrower. When I double click it, it does consume. I bought a stack before prepping this video. I'm now down to 200. When I double click it, you'll see our character does actually equip a flamethrower. And we have 5 skills. These are the engineer kit skills for flamethrower, pretty much 100%. I'd actually feel quite bad if I was an engineer main, as if there is such a thing as being a pure main in Guild Wars 2 these days. As it is kind of like, hey, one of our weapons is straight up dumped on all 9 available professions. So what this allows you to do is to use engineer skills with guardian traits, utilities, and profession mechanics, so you get the guardian virtues and so on. And this is actually a particularly potent combo on core guards, which is what I want to talk about. So for the other videos, I've been giving you a demonstration of how things run beforehand, but this time I think I do need to describe how the build functions in principle first of all. So let's look at what the flamethrower itself actually does. First of all, a lot of its skills apply burn. In fact, all of them do except the skill 5, which is a little blind pulse and we don't worry about too much. So we have a napalm wall that we can drop burning out on. That'll take one stack of burn on the target every second that it's rolling, and it lasts a really long time. We have air blast, which is break bar damage, but also 2 stacks of burn. We have the flame blast, which rolls napalm out in a ball. It will cleave everyone in it and then explode at the end. This is like Phoenix for the Ellie, but it doesn't come back to you. But this does pierce, and so, for example, if I cast it behind the Sardava here, it will do a bit of burn first and then a bit more burn afterwards. You'll also notice as I attacked him there, we aggroed all these other ones. And, well, that will become very clear why that happened in just a moment. So then lastly, you have the auto attack. And the auto attack rolls in a fairly short space of time, just 2.25 seconds, which you can speed up with quickness, 10 packets of damage, okay? It lists 1 burn there as well. That isn't 10 burn per auto attack. That's 1 burn on the last bit. So if you watch this mower here, we do get several burnout. That's because of my traits, which we'll look at in a second, but we didn't get 10, okay? So it's not 1 burn every packet. It's just a bit of burn at the end. And it also does flat damage on there, an increased flat damage, in fact, if the target was already burning. So that's the way that the Engineer's Flamethrower Kit works. We don't have a tool belt on Guardian, so we miss out on the extra little fire damage, the burning damage that you can get if we were actually an engineer with the tool belt. But this is still pretty good. So why does this synergize with Core Guardian? Well, it's because of the way that Core Guardian's passive works for their F1, the Virtue of Justice. So what Virtue of Justice does passively is it means we burn foes every few attacks we deal. The fire you can see on the user interface behind my flamethrower here is the passive of the virtue building up. Every time we strike, the fire grows and grows and grows, and then once it reaches a certain amount of fire, our next attack hits more burning. So that will do it every few attacks, and that's why our flamethrower autos, which deliver 10 separate packets of damage, synergize really well on Guardian, because we can actually get multiple Guardian Virtue fire out while using our flame jet. So already you can see the synergy. If I just give myself quickness, say from my elite skill, and then I auto attack, we're getting tons of burning out, okay? Now the important thing is, The Virtue rolls up every hit. So if we only have one target on his own, then, you know, it will roll fairly slowly. But if we can hit two targets at once, then it will roll twice as quick. And the Flame Jet will hit actually up to three targets. So if you're getting this AoE, every little auto can be a renewable 30 strikes, which will each of them will roll the fire, and then you're going to trigger the Virtue lots of times. So if I have just one guy, we're not going to burn him too much. But if you saw when I killed those three a second ago, we burnt him way more. We burnt them all way more, like instantly burst well over 10 stacks onto all of them. So that's the synergy at play here. And you can, in fact, on Guardian, build really heavily around this. Because when you take three core specialization lines, and I love that this is a meaningful core Condi build, by the way, each time you have an option to go some kind of big burn applicator or to play with the Virtue. So let's start off first of all with the line Virtues themselves, okay? This specialization is all about augmenting our F abilities. And so we can take various traits, but when you get to the Grandmaster slot, you have one for F3, you have one for F2, and then you have one for F1. F1 is what's building this fire for us. So let's look at this first of all. Permeating Wrath. Virtue of Justice's passive now triggers more quickly and is AoE. So, wow, this is now scaling insanely. Instead of us having to attack five times, we only have to attack three times for the fire to instantly grow really big and pop on Permeating Wrath, okay? And now it's triggering AoE. When this splashes out AoE, you'll notice there isn't actually a flat packet of damage on there too, but it's still very strong, okay? What it means is that when we trigger it against three targets, which we will be triggering very regularly, like if I just hit this one Sadava, it's going to aggro the one next to it, the guy next to it, but and this guy over here came in and started aggroing. Now, why are they aggroing like that? You might think, oh, that's just what Guild Wars 2's mechanics are like for aggro. It's actually not. The reason that they're aggroing in really quickly is because Permeating Wrath is triggering and burning them. Just from standing vaguely near something else, they're getting burnt, and then that's taking them some damage, and then it's counting as an aggro. So Permeating Wrath is one of them. Look at another DPS line on Radiance. We have Amplified Wrath. So burning we inflict does increased damage. Now remember, burning is already a condition that hits extremely hard baseline. On Amplified Wrath, you've just bumped that up even more. That's without, you know, that won't overcap with might or whatever. You can take both. And then also, burning duration applied by our Virtue of Justice's passive is increased. So Amplified Wrath is making our blue fire burn for longer, and Permeating Wrath is making it AoE. So these two are like made for each other. Amplified, Permeating Wrath. You get them together. And then finally, if we go Zeal, there's another Grandmaster. Now this one's a new kind of thing as of recent balance, but it's called Eternal Armory. So this is also a brilliant burn trait. It's about spirit weapons though. It means we can spam spirit weapons more. They recharge quicker. We have higher counts and now they burn on hit. So it's two burn per strike. Now, if we look at the Sword of Justice, this is how its animation rolls. It lands in an area and it keeps striking. It will strike out four times, but that again is AoE. So that is actually able to hit five targets four times. Every single one of those hits already does two burn, and then every one of those hits can roll out more Permeating Wrath for us. So if I cast this on this mower, just the sword, we just put 10 stacks of burn. That's one target. If we had five targets that we hit there, well, the burn is going insane. We're hitting like 30 burn in one skill straight away, right? And maybe I can demo that. Well, hold on. Let's see what we can do. If I aggro this mower with this skill, I make him stand next to this mower, and then I put the sword next to them both. Okay. This is just a two-target scenario. We've triggered another trait there. But we went up to 13 burn. Like they're dead too quickly, right? So this is all before we look at the flamethrower. This is like the big synergy. You guys can take whatever you like for the other traits. Here's what I've slotted. I've gone with Inner Fire for Fury. I've gone with Radiant Fire, which means when I crit, I get a free Torch 4. That's this animation, which is pulsing more burnout. I'm running a Torch myself. For Virtues, I'm taking extra damage while I have Aegis. I'm taking Condi Cleanse on F2, but you could do whatever you like with these, really. And then for Zeal, this one's actually quite good. Zealous Scepter is gain might whenever our blue fire caps out, right? So we're doing that constantly, which means you're going to get 25 might from this, right? Let me clarify. You're going to get 25 might when you're getting a lot of AoE. Otherwise, you might want to use other might access. And yes, while you're holding the bundle item, the flamethrower, as long as you are on the scepter weapon set underneath, the scepter trait will still trigger, the modifiers will still be there. Same with its sigils. You don't need to be holding a scepter, but I'm also holding a scepter underneath. So what you can do is you can drop scepter 2, the swords, you can give yourself quickness, get into your flamethrower. You can even be pulsing your torch out here as well. The damage is mental. And then lastly, I'm taking Kindled Zeal, which gives me condition damage based on my power. So really it's about the three grandmasters though. Let's look back at the flamethrower again. And you'll see one thing that's really good about napalm is it's not just burn on pulse, but it's also got that little bit of flat damage on there. Do you see that 59 damage? But that 59 damage, we don't really care about the damage itself. We just care that it's doing a packet. The fact it's doing a packet is if you watch behind my skills right now, when I cast this, oh my god, we missed. Will one of them walk into it? Please walk into it. Oh, they're not. I can't believe it. It's on a fairly long cooldown. Basically, this will build the fire for us too. So this is 8 procs. And again, it's all AoE, okay? So really, this is the synergy that's at play here. You get your AoEs out and you start rolling the flamethrower damage. It's extremely strong, but it also lacks a lot of quality of life. The one thing that you cannot do on this build, okay, is activate the Virtue of Justice. If you activate it, the design of Guardian is each one of our virtues. They give us a passive. This one's regenerating health. This one's giving us Aegis every now and then. This one is giving us the burns. This is giving us, if we activate it, we don't get the fire anymore. We don't get it. Now, we are a Radiance Guardian, so this trait here means every time we score a kill, we get it back. So if you are scoring a lot of kills, like I could totally kill this mower. I could activate it, and then when the mower dies, you know, I'm gonna get it back and we'll start rebuilding our fire. And you can in fact spam this to give yourself 25 might even without the Zealous Scepter if you're scoring enough kills. But I kind of just leave this alone, all right? Mostly I leave this alone. You would spam out blinds and retail and light aura as well on this specific setup if you were doing that. So that's the synergy. There's really not much else to say. I would run Litany of Wrath if I were you. I would run Fill My Wrath so that you get quickness flamethrower autos. This slot is totally negotiable. I was running it for a bit of resustain against a champion that I'm going to show you me fighting a second ago. Wall of Reflection is kind of fun if you know that there's a lot of reflection stuff, because enemies will shoot into the wall, they'll reflect themselves, and that counts as a packet of damage for you building more fire. And, you know, the Wall of Reflection is always good. If you are running this, it's a consecration. Obviously, you can take the consecration trait when you are set up like this. But definitely do keep a hold of the Sword of Justice. The food that you're going to see me using in a second is Toxic Focusing Crystals for lots of condition damage. Ghost Pepper Poppers for Might during the day and Chill and Break Bar Drain during the night. And for the gear, on this specific setup, I'm running Viper's Armor and Viper's Weapons. Okay, these are all Vipers. I'm running Balthazar Runes, a Sigil of Malice, and Sigil of Strength for Might. Now, the sigils and the specific balance you do here could be tweaked slightly. I'm sure if people want to go really hardcore with the Theorycraft, they could do this. But that brings me just to 100%. Like, if I unequip my torch here, you'll see we're at 97.7% burning. And then this torch has a little bit more expertise on it, which just pushes us to the 100% mark. We might be slightly over, obviously, right? But ever so slightly. And then, because we're already at 100% just from this, my trinkets are actually all grieving. So that's power, precision, ferocity, and condition damage with Condi on the high stack, because we don't need any more expertise at this point. You could definitely mix it up. You could change the runes you're running and sub in more Vipers or whatever. The gear itself is largely expansion gear, both Vipers and Grieving, so you do want to own those. It's not necessarily a noob-friendly build in terms of accessing a lot of this, but it would still be extremely devastating, even on stuff like Sinister or Rabid or carrying some of the classic ones. It will be devastating even on exotic gear, but this is the way that I just kind of quickly built this here. That's the way that you can utilize this. So let's talk about where we get the flamethrower, and let's see the build in action now that you know the actual combo around various areas of Tyria. Now, I will note, this consumable did already have one balance pass on it years ago. That means it's not available in World versus World or Dungeons. Like, they manually actually made sure it can't even be used in Dungeons. Some of this other stuff can be. This cannot. So, no raids, no fractals, no World versus World, no PvP, no Dungeons even. It really is just open world and story missions. So, of course, you're going to have to claim the flamethrower from somewhere in open world. You're going to get it from the last map. I actually rather like that one of the most overpowered consumables currently in the game is available right near the end of the Cursed Shore. So the task is to defeat this champion ooze near Meddler's Waypoint, pretty much the last big base of the core game. And it spawns fairly regularly, but because it's right next to a place where lots of players hang out, a very frequent waypoint, it tends to die quick too. So keep an eye out. Once that's done, this NPC will appear here at the camp for only 2 minutes. You get 120 seconds to buy these. So nowadays we can just bulk buy. So here you can see I pick up 2 stacks. It costs a bit of gold. If this was launched, this would have actually felt quite pricey. Nowadays, I don't think so much for most of us. And there you go. You now have the flamethrowers. The flamethrowers do run out as well. After you equip it, I think you get somewhere around a minute before it will despawn in your hands. So do buy plenty. I think 2 stacks, 500, is more than enough for several hours of gameplay without compromising on your inventory too much. But that's kind of up to you guys. And if I may be so bold, I would also suggest you set your inventory up. I know it's a mess at the moment, such that the item is on the top left, your shared inventory slots are at the bottom, and then you can hide the inventory in a corner, like this, for example. I have my mini map at the top, but whatever works for you. So you can easily just click over on the side there when you drop the flamethrower in combat and get a new one. When you do drop it because it despawns, that's generally your time to throw out another focus strike or get another symbol up or maybe swap to your other set, like say a sword shield or whatever, do some break bar damage and then get the next flamethrower up. You don't want to be opening and closing your inventory constantly. So this is a good technique. Very useful for some fractal consumables and some, which I've talked about quite regularly on the channel. So let's close the video down, looking at the build in action. Starting where I opened with just killing some spiders at the Penitent Pass, where you notice we do like 1 flamethrower auto there and a Sword of Justice, and they all completely melt. I love looking at the burn stacks on this. Just pay attention to how quickly the might goes up and the burn stacks. So this is what you'll typically find in PvE, stuff like defense events here. A group of mobs come in, they all blow up, and there might be one veteran amongst them who unfortunately then eats 30 burns in a mere moment. Look at this second wave. Look how fast they all die. Actually, I think some of those died because the event ended. But still, that's the way that PvE is often structured. And for those kinds of events, that's where it shines. Here I want to show you the giant. I showed you the giant on the ice gun build too before it was nerfed. And I kind of wanted to show just a single target environment with this one. You'll see it's still plenty capable of burning things down, even if they're fairly tanky. Back to Penitent. It's not just defense events that are really good for this, where you get waves coming in, but it's escorts too, where as we walk forward, we tend to find groups and clumps of mobs that we can fight. Especially, you'll realize this is great anywhere where stuff is scaling heavily. So if we were currently in a Zerg with 15, 20 to 50 people, not only would there be tons more mobs, so our AoE would work much better, but they also get a lot tankier. So the fact that we're putting so much burn up also has relevance. We're not overkilling. A lot of this stuff, like as you watch when we come to Path of Fire here, where it's just as good, you know, we've got huge stacks of burns on mobs that die before they run out, you know. It doesn't feel good to see something die while it still has like 20 burn on it. Well, when these events start scaling up really big, then all of a sudden you can get really heavy value out of it. And if you're running like a DPS meter looking at your cleave, you're just gonna be the biggest cleave out there. It's ridiculous. Obviously, AoEing is a big thing, so when I was fighting those troublemakers there, you saw I line-of-sighted them around the pyramid, and you're going to find you do that a little bit more on this build, because it does become increasingly weaker the less you can ball stuff up. Taking it to a more prominent meta event, say as a part of an expansion, here we are in Verdant Brink, you'll see as soon as the Zerg's around, you have other people supporting you, helping you with some of those boons and things, you just get to keep autoing. You can keep that uptime as much as possible, dropping the napalm walls. I actually, at the start of this fight, had the wrong condition floaters on, so you couldn't really see. But here you'll notice we move into the next phase, and I'll get up like over 20k burn very, very quick. Sorry, over 10k burn very, very quickly, even single target, right? And the more that we can drag together, the better. We are getting one shot here, and let me restate, this is a low quality of life build. This does not have the quality of life of, say, the main Firebrand build that I've been recommending to you, but if you want to bring the big damage, this is still good. And the main reason I'm actually getting knocked out here is because of his mechanic, where you have to break the break bar, and other people aren't contributing. I can a little bit, but if I want to contribute a lot, I kind of have to drop the flamethrower. I wasn't worrying. Nonetheless, we can kill the creature pretty quickly, and we don't have to worry. Speaking of Firebrand, it is possible to run a Firebrand setup here. You could drop the Zeal line and the idea of the Spirit Weapons in Eternal Armory to then get lots of quickness out of Firebrand, get your axe back, maybe some extra CCs. I did want to show you as well this here, though, the Chuck Geront, where depending on which lane you go to, you can have both a big boss to cleave down and Lots of ads, especially like over at the Scar Lane. Lots of things end up running around. I'm specifically at Newhock here because I never trust people to be able to get the spores at Newhock. And what you're going to see here is we actually one burn the Garant down. I don't know how much is actually related to me. There's probably a lot of other people doing very good. In fact, I go down a couple of times in this fight just because of poor positioning. But it is one of those builds where as long as you just stand in the right place, you WASD out of the bullet hell, look at the burn right now. He's up to 60 burn. A lot of that's going to be coming from us. And here, still with 20 seconds on the clock, we're actually going to kill him in phase one. It's more common, absolutely, now in the Path of Fire days with the power creep. But a lot of it is this build. When you see a Guardian, especially like a Core Guard, is massively out DPSing you, it's probably because he's running this. In fact, I had a very enthusiastic fan message me on Reddit specifically about this event last night, so I thought I'd throw it in for them. Coming back to Core, let's talk about quality of life and fighting champions, all right? So a lot of the best builds to me are the ones where you feel like you have the power to take out any kind of difficult champ, even when you're on your own. And you're going to see how much more this build struggles. You can see how much damage it does, but also how much it struggles too. As much as I'd like to ball these enemies up for AoE and taking out the champion Risen Archmage in a second, the CC and the weakness and other nasty stuff they put on me just threatens me to the point where I kind of don't want to. Here I'm trying to use the Wall of Reflection to stop his autos, but I'm not even sure whether it really works, to be honest. And just trying to keep some range. I don't even have the flamethrower out yet. I'm just trying to exhaust my torch cooldowns, my scepter stuff before I finally go into it. So here's the flamethrower. We drop the napalm down. You can check his burn stacks as they keep rolling. We manage to sustain 25 might as long as we continue being able to hit. But you see when he CCs us? Like, we really lose a lot of ramp when we can't keep striking back. And actually, flat damage is a big part on this as well. If you rewind this demonstration, you'll see we do roll over 10k on a lot of these autos and as we keep spamming the flamethrower, just because we don't actually need that much expertise. We've got that extra grieving in there. You get the extra ferocity out of the build. So it is challenging to kill stuff. You know, this guy does threaten me. I can't just go completely ham and hope to instantly win. I have to keep my space. I have to watch his animations, stay out of his lightning storms. In fact, here he even gets me down. We have good rally potential, though. I instantly get back up because of my Signet of Agony there, because of the Napalm Wall. Maybe a Sword of Justice was up. But ultimately, you can get the kill with good play. It's another reason why I don't actually recommend this for new players, because of the gear accessibility, but also, it's just not as face roll as you can at make the game. Looking over at Season 4, some of the most recent content, you have events like this one for the Specimen Chamber, where you are on a defense against waves and waves of Inquest for like 5 minutes. And it's places like this that the build is perfect. Even in new content, here you actually get karma from every single kill, so this is actually a pretty epic farm. Even following this event, after you get all the waves, there's a boss phase where you're fighting two bosses at once. If you can try to get them together and work that correctly, you can do big damage. I'll show you what that looked like there as well. I think they actually get more dangerous when that occurs. Some raiders have actually caught onto this concept as of a while now at the top end. Utilizing Permeating Wrath in raid encounters like Sabbath is really good, but they don't get the extra flamethrower element, which we do here out in the open world. In fact, I know there's a few other consumables that drop other lingering small roaming AoEs that might be kind of fun to mess with too. But then we're getting really kind of out there with the quality of life. So yeah, I did want to show this concept off. Take it out there. Go anywhere where there's lots of mobs. Places like Harathi Hinterlands, I'm not going to show in this demonstration. But also would be completely insane. World bosses with lots of mobs lingering around, like Tida with those extra pirates near her. She teleports around the base. Surely I don't need to remind you of Season 3's and Heart of Thorn's pocket raptors, scarabs from some of the more recent content. Anything with loads of, like, look at the cleave we're getting here. It's absolutely insane. Anything with lots of mobs. It's definitely not my top recommendation. And frankly, a huge part of this is just the Guardian build craft. I've actually taken a concept like this into PvP before for a fun, gimmicky ranged nuker, and it's worked. And you obviously don't get the flamethrower there. But here in Open World and Story, it's just taking it to that other level. Also, I hope you guys enjoyed. Thanks very much for watching. If you're interested in the rest of my build videos and some more legitimate ones, perhaps, feel free to click the link at the top of the description. It will take you to a playlist where I have a video about gear, and I'm currently rolling through videos on all the professions, including a very strong Firebrand variant that I published just last night. There'll be more to come, guys. Thanks again. Take it easy, and let me know what you think. See you next time.